like your grace is stronger. The first time I ever preached in a church, it was in a tiny no-stop sign town in eastern Iowa. And it was a disaster. But I'm not sure anybody noticed. I was a senior in college when I decided I was called to go to seminary. I wasn't sure I really wanted to be a preacher, but I wasn't sure what else I wanted to do either. I just knew I liked being in school, and I liked studying the Bible. So anything that could prolong my educational experience and allow to be about Jesus, I was good for that. So I told my friend and campus pastor, Ron Bartlett, that I was thinking about going to seminary, and he said, well, then you need to get some experience preaching. And because most of his ministry took place on campus during the week, he often got calls from area churches to come and speak on the weekends. And so instead of going and doing all of those speaking engagements himself, he started to funnel them towards me. And so my first assignment was actually a dual assignment. Two churches about 7 miles apart that shared one pastor. And they were small churches, and instead of having everybody go to one church and just having one combined service together, they made the pastor go from one church to the other, and they stayed in their individual buildings. So the day came, and Beth and I drove out to that first church, and I made her drive because I was trying to get my breathing under control, very nervous. And we found this church, and we got there about 30 minutes before it was scheduled to start, and the first sign that things weren't going to go so well, we were the first ones there. The church was still locked. It took about 15 minutes before someone showed up to open the door, and about 5 minutes before the service started, there were like 9 people there. By the time church started, maybe 15 or so. I don't remember much about the actual service other than it was very painful. We sang several songs, but nobody in the congregation sang very much, so I could hear myself singing, and that's always a bad thing. I think they could hear me singing. Maybe that's why they weren't singing either. Again, I remember being very, very nervous. I sweat a lot when I'm nervous, and I remember I was in full soak mode. I was wearing a suit, and that shirt was just, we threw it away after that. But nobody seemed all that engaged with what I was saying. Now, it wasn't a very good message, but I got the distinct impression that nobody really cared. If I had been Billy Graham, I'm not sure it would have changed their interest all that much. When the service was over, Beth and I were supposed to get in the car and hustle over to the other church service, and yet I think we were still the second to last car to leave. Nobody wanted to stay around and visit. Nobody seemed glad to be there. And the other church had a slightly larger crowd, but the atmosphere wasn't much different. It was a group of people who looked like they were getting their church obligations out of the way for the week. People who were keeping their church going out of a sense of duty. Over the next several months, Ron lined up other preaching opportunities for me, and most of the churches I entered felt the same way. If I hadn't been the speaker, they were churches I never would have chosen to attend. And I didn't realize it then, but God was beginning to create a vision in me. My frustration, the thing that broke my heart, were churches that made serving and worshiping God feel like taking your medicine. You know it's good for you, you know you're supposed to do it, but it doesn't taste very good. I was becoming discontent over churches that made the whole church experience into something to be endured, rather than an experience of joy. And so the vision that God was creating in my heart was for a church experience that would be fun. I believed then, I still believe today, that living your life for Jesus Christ means you're living the best possible life there is to live. And so when people who love Jesus gather, it should be exciting. We should sing passionately. We should enjoy one another's company. We should discover new things about God together. We should find purpose and direction. And so the vision that God was birthing in me, and which still guides my life as far as my professional life is concerned, is that church should be a place where we experience joy. I want to lead a church that people look forward to coming to, people are excited to come to and excited to leave. Well, no, not that. That's not quite right. What I mean is I want to have a church where people are excited to come here on Sunday morning, but then when we leave, you don't leave like, you know, well, I'm glad I got that out of the way for the week, but you leave excited and passionate and ready to put into practice, you know, recharged from the experience of being here to live your life for God that week. That's what fires me up. That's the kind of place I'm striving to make Hope Church. So that's my vision. We've been talking about God's vision for you the last couple of weeks, and I thought, well, I'll tell you what mine is. That's what drives, that's what defines my life, has defined my life for the past 20 years. There's no excuse for boring church. And so I don't want to lead a church that's boring. But the series isn't about my vision. It's about yours. It's about discovering what God is calling you to do, what God is calling you to make your life about. It's my hope that by the time we get to the end of this series, all of us will be able to write out in clear and compelling way what we believe to be God's vision for us for the stage of life we're in. And so to do that, we're working our way through the book of Nehemiah. The first thing we saw a couple weeks ago is that you need to know what breaks your heart. What's your holy discontent? What fires you up? We saw for Nehemiah, it was the broken condition of Jerusalem's walls. It broke his heart. The city of God was in disrepair. The name of God was being laughed at because Jerusalem was in such a bad state. And so it broke his heart, and so he wanted to do something about it. And last week we saw that we need to pray and then act. Pray first and then act. We saw Nehemiah praying to the God of heaven to make a difference in this situation in Jerusalem. And more than that, to give Nehemiah an opportunity to make a difference in Jerusalem. And then we saw when that opportunity came, very boldly, Nehemiah stepped into it. Nehemiah took a chance to ask the king for permission to go to Jerusalem and change the condition of the walls. And now today, we're going to continue to follow Nehemiah as he puts his vision into motion. We're going to be looking at the second half of chapter 2 and all of chapter 3. And we're going to organize this section of scripture around three key words: inspection, inspiration, and mobilization. So, let's start with inspection. As we seek to form a vision for what can be, it's important that we acknowledge first what is broken. The first thing Nehemiah does when he arrives in Jerusalem is take stock of the situation. This is Nehemiah chapter 2, starting at verse 11. He says, "I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few men, and not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on, and by night I went out through the valley gate toward the jackal wall and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. And then I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through, so I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. And finally I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. And the officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or officials or any officers who would be doing the work." When last we left Nehemiah, he just mustered up the courage to ask King Artaxerxes for permission to go to Jerusalem and start rebuilding the walls. Artaxerxes, you'll remember, was the king who'd actually commanded that the work on rebuilding Jerusalem's wall stopped. It wasn't exactly Persian imperial policy to let conquered peoples refortify their cities. But the great and awesome God worked on the heart of Artaxerxes and opened the way for him to appoint Nehemiah as the new governor of Israel, to give him a line of credit at the local Home Depot, send him west with a contingent of army officers and cavalry. But when Nehemiah arrives in Jerusalem, he doesn't immediately announce his intentions to set to work on the wall. He's too good of a politician for that. And I mean that in the best sense of that word, politician. He understands that the people of Jerusalem are going to look with suspicion on anybody who's just come from the capital, you know, appointed by the emperor to be in charge here. And they're not likely to just spring into action just because Nehemiah says that's what they're going to do. He also understands that there's plenty of resistance to the idea of rebuilding these walls. Some people, as we're going to see, especially next week, are flat out opposed to anything that might promote the welfare of the Israelites. Others are just so discouraged by the state of affairs that they see it as an impossible task. So before Nehemiah says anything publicly, he inspects the wall for himself. And there's an important principle for us here. I say it like this: inspect first. Walk before you talk. Investigate before you initiate. Just because God has placed something on our hearts doesn't mean we have to take off half-cocked and just jump right in. It's neither smart nor heroic to take action before you have at least some grasp of the facts. It's not a lack of faith to ask hard questions before making a move. We've already observed Nehemiah was a patient man, willing to pray for 4 months before he even opened the question to the emperor. There's nothing wrong with having a plan. It's a good idea to aim before you shoot. So quietly, secretly, Nehemiah arranges for an inspection tour of the walls. He's heard that the walls were in disrepair. Now he wants to see for himself. What he's proposing to do, what he's dreaming of doing, is no small task. Scholars suggest that the wall around Jerusalem at this time would have been about a mile in circumference. On an average, it would have been 3 to 4 feet thick, about 15 to 20 feet high. So to rebuild a mile-long wall at 4 feet of width and 15 to 20 feet high, this is a major construction project. And Nehemiah is going to get it accomplished in a little more than 7 weeks. It's going to take 52 days to rebuild this wall. So it's a major undertaking. So before Nehemiah starts, he needs to see it for himself. He needs to know what he's up against. He needs to see the challenges and the problems that he's about to confront. So here's another important principle. We need to inspect honestly. It's important that as Nehemiah makes his circuit of the wall, that he come away with an honest and realistic assessment of the situation. It won't do anybody any good if he misunderstands the challenges. You can't say, well, this gate isn't that bad, or this section of the wall, really. Well, maybe that, for him to downplay the seriousness of the condition of the walls would not help have a good wall in the end. So as you develop your vision, it's important that you take an honest assessment of where things stand. Whether your vision is for your family, or for your place of work, or your business, or for your church, or whatever, it begins with a clear understanding of where the weaknesses are. Before you can paint a clear picture of the future, you need to be able to say, this is where we are right now. And Nehemiah was able to do this for Jerusalem because he was able to look at the situation with fresh eyes. He brought an objective perspective to the condition of the wall. A lot of the people who were living in Jerusalem, they'd grown comfortable with the walls as they were. I mean, everybody knows you can't have a city with broken down walls. But they lived with it for so long, it'd become like the wallpaper. It's just the way things were. It took someone like Nehemiah to come and sort of point out where the problem areas were. Think of it this way. When I was a kid, I used to play at a neighbor's house, and every time I went inside, I'd notice the smell. And it wasn't a bad smell, not an awful smell, maybe kind of like leftovers, a little musty something. Maybe they had something in their basement. I don't know. But I remember every time I went into this house, I kept wondering, why don't they do something about this smell? And my guess is it's because they were so used to it, they didn't even realize it smelled anymore. Just like I'm sure if the same kid came to my house, they probably wondered why we didn't do something about the smell in our house. You become so used to it, sometimes it takes fresh eyes or a fresh nose to come in and kind of point out what's wrong. So as we dream about things changing in our business or at school or with our friends or in our family, you need to step back and look at the situation objectively. You need to inspect the walls to see where they're breaking down. And this can be painful sometimes, especially when we've had a hand in making the walls the way they are, right? In our family, in our work, here at church, it's hard to admit when things are not as good as they should be. That's why it's a lot easier to inspect someone else's walls than to inspect our own. But if we're not willing to identify areas of weakness and our contribution to it, then we're no longer engaging in mission. We're involved in an exercise of self-preservation. If our only goal is to keep things the way they are, regardless of the dysfunction or ineffectiveness of things, then we aren't about growth. We're only about protecting our own pride. See, God wants the walls to be stronger in your family, here at church. He wants the walls to be strong. So it's key that we take an objective look at where the weaknesses lie. But let me say one more thing about that. We should also inspect constructively. Keep in mind that Nehemiah was examining the walls for the sake of rebuilding. He knew what he wanted to do. He wanted to make things better. He wasn't there just to find fault for the sake of finding fault. He wasn't interested in just pointing out all of the problems to the people who lived in Jerusalem. He was there to do something about it. Too many people inspect just for the sake of inspecting. They like to find fault because they like pointing out problems to other people. They criticize, not constructively, but critically. I'll give you a personal example. Here at church, as a pastor, this is where I live, this is where I put my energy. I love it when someone comes up to me and says, "Pastor, you know, here's something in our church that I think could be stronger, and I'd like to be involved in it. Here's a place where we can make things better." I love that. But when somebody comes up to me and says, "You know, Pastor, you should really do this or that," or "Pastor, you know, our church isn't very good at this," and then they just sort of leave it there, and they leave it on my, you know, at my office door, like, now it's my problem. That just feels like criticism. You know, when someone comes and says, "Hey, I want to be a part of making things better," that's constructive, that's fun. But when we just point out flaws for the sake of pointing out flaws, whether that's in your family or in your business, nobody finds that to be much fun. So the first thing Nehemiah does is he inspects, and we need to do that as well. Walk before we talk. Inspect for the sake of rebuilding. From inspection, then Nehemiah moves on to inspiration. In order to carry out our vision, we're going to need to rally others to the cause. Now that he's seen the situation for himself, Nehemiah is ready to go public with his dream. So verses 17 and 18. "Then I said to them, 'You see the trouble we're in. Jerusalem lies in ruins. Its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. We will no longer be in disgrace.' I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me and what the king had said to me." Here is the statement. This is Nehemiah's vision. Here's his vision statement. Sometimes we call this vision casting. He's taking this picture of a preferred future now, and he's sharing it with others. He's laying the burden of his heart out there so that others can feel it as well. Let me point out a few things here. Nehemiah comes alongside of the Jews. He says, "You see the trouble we are in." He says, "We, not you." He's not just this high-powered official come from the Persian capital to tell them how to run their city, but he identifies with them. He's one of them. He's Jewish. The condition of Jerusalem's walls matter to him. So he says, "We, not you." It's his problem as much as it is theirs. For another thing, he's very clear about the problem. Jerusalem lies in ruins. Its gates have been burned with fire. He doesn't mince words. He doesn't sugarcoat it. He doesn't try to downplay it. You know, he's like the kid who walks into somebody's house and says, "Your house smells funny." This is an untenable situation. Something needs to be done. But he also proposes a solution to the problem. "Come, let's rebuild the wall. There is a way to make things better." And I'm sure he's not the first to suggest that the wall should be rebuilt. But he has a couple of things that others perhaps have lacked. For one thing, he inspires motivation. He says, "We'll no longer be in disgrace." See, this is about more than crumbling walls or burned out gates. The condition of the city is a judgment on the people of Israel. It's a blemish on the reputation of God. And so now he's casting a picture of a preferred future. He says, now we're in disgrace, but if we rebuild this wall, things will be different. We won't be a laughingstock among the nations anymore. The name of God won't be in disrepute. So Nehemiah paints a picture of what can be different. He provides a motivation for why they should do what he's proposing they do. And this is an important element as you share your vision with others. How will things be different if your vision is carried out? What's the motivation for somebody to get involved? And whether your vision is a big one, like getting thousands of people to sign up to sponsor children in impoverished countries around the world, or if it's a small one, like getting your family to do devotions after supper. Either way, you have to answer the question, how will things be different if we do this? What will change? What will improve because of this? So he inspires motivation. Also, notice Nehemiah inspires confidence. He says in verse 18 that he told them the story of how the gracious hand of God was upon him. He told them what the king had said. What we looked at last week, Nehemiah goes back and he tells them, you know, it looks like the rebuilding this wall is an impossible task, but it looked like getting the king to even allow us to consider it would be an impossible task. But he tells them about how he prayed and about how God created the opportunity and Artaxerxes opened the door for him to start talking about the walls in Jerusalem. And he talks about how God is involved in this. And so as you develop your vision, you need to be clear about where God is at work. How has God led you to this place? Where is the evidence that this is something God would want you to do? Andy Stanley writes this. He says, people will give what they feel they can afford to meet a need. But they will give sacrificially toward a vision that bears the marks of God's involvement. See, there will always be needs. The list is endless. But when an opportunity comes along to invest our time and resources in something God is up to, it's amazing how much more of our time and treasure we're willing to invest. So Stanley says this, if this is a vision God has placed on your heart, and if this is, in fact, the time to act on it, there should be something of a divine nature to point to, something that will indicate people that God has gone before you to prepare the way. People want to be a part of something God is up to. They will join you in your vision if they're convinced it's more than just your vision. And so Nehemiah gives the people confidence that this is something God is a part of. He's opened the doors to this point, so certainly God wants them to continue on and tackle that wall. Nehemiah told a clear and compelling story. He painted a desirable picture of the future, and the people responded. The end of verse 18. They replied, let us start rebuilding. And so they began this good work. The people of Jerusalem had been so demoralized and defeated, suddenly had a vision they could believe in. And so they rallied to the cause. But not everybody. Verses 19 and 20. This doesn't exactly fit my outline today, but it's sort of foreshadowing for what we'll talk about next week. So I'll read it here. When Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this you're doing, they asked. Are you rebelling against the king? I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We are his servants, and we will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it. This is going to be the topic of our discussion next week. What do you do when there's opposition to your vision? What do you do with those obstacles in your way? Here, these three, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, these are Nehemiah's obstacles. So we'll talk about them next week. But before we look at dealing with opposition, we need to see how the people responded to Nehemiah's call to action. And so that's chapter 3. The last section of our scripture today I'm going to label mobilization. This is the actual building of the wall. We need to do our part in God's great work. Nehemiah chapter 3 lists the names of those who participated in this construction project. So I'm going to read a portion of it. I'm not going to read the whole thing. It's about 28 verses or so, but I'll give you a taste. Nehemiah 3, starting verse 1. Eliashib the high priest and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hananel. And the men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. And the fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hassanah. And they laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. And Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakaz, repaired the next section. And next to him, Meshullam, son of Berechiah, the son of Meshezebel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Bana, also made repairs. And the next section, verse 5, was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. And the Jeshanah gate was repaired by Joiada, son of Pesiah, and Meshullam, son of Besaidah, something. Remember what I said a few weeks ago? If you don't know how to pronounce a name, just say it with confidence and people will believe you. They laid its beams, put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Next to them, repairs were made by Gibeon, Mizpah, Melatiah of Gibeon, and Jadon of Meronoth, places under the authority of the governor of Trans-Euphrates. Uzziel, son of Harhai, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that, and they restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. And it goes on like this. One more section. Rephai, son of ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section, and adjoining this, Jediah, son of I can't even read that with confidence, made repairs opposite his house, and Hattus, son of Heshish, well, that one's even worse, made repairs next to him, and Melchijah, son of Haram, and Hashab, son of Pathamoab, repaired another section in the Tower of the Ovens, and Shalom, son of Helahesh, ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. And it goes on and on and on. Part of me feels like I should just read the whole chapter. I mean, and here's why. I mean, these are the people who rebuilt the wall of Jerusalem. I think it's great that Nehemiah names them and lists them and includes them here. I realize most of us, when we get to this section, this is one of those parts of Scripture you skim over. I get that. If you are an expectant parent and you were hoping to give your child a biblical name, here's some good hunting ground. Hashabadniah. So that's why they're there. That's why they're listed. But I read as much as I did because I wanted to give you a taste of it as well. What Nehemiah is saying is these are the people, these are the heroes, these are the ones who went to work on Jerusalem. These are the ones who went to work on the wall. A couple of things that I want you to notice here. He mobilized everyone. You read about priests and goldsmiths and perfume makers. I mean, what does a perfume maker know about building a wall? They should have gave him the dung gate, at least. That way you could make that smell better. There are men and women, that the families involved. A lot of people mentioned from a lot of different walks of life. What happened is Nehemiah rallied the people living in Jerusalem to go to work on the section of wall right across from their living quarters. You read that a lot. A lot of them worked on the section of the wall right across from their homes. And that makes sense because if you're investing in your protection, you want to make sure the part of the wall that's most directly going to contribute to your protection, that would be strong and solid. But then there are also a lot of people listed in there who didn't even live in Jerusalem. People from Jericho and from Gibeon and Jadon and the areas beyond the Euphrates. People who lived outside the walls but still realized how important it was for Jerusalem to be built. So everyone got involved, whether they had a direct stake in it or not. I think there's a principle there for us as well, especially as it relates to the church, that we can be involved, that we can rally to the cause, whether we have a direct stake in what's happening or not. I think of like some of you whose children are grown and gone. You're empty nesters now. You've raised your children, but you could still volunteer in the children's program. You could still get involved in the youth ministry. You don't have a direct stake in it anymore, but you see the good that will come of having a strong children's ministry. Maybe you're younger, and you haven't thought about retirement or that sort of thing. But we have older members of our church, and even though you're younger and you're not there yet, you could get involved and minister to them and serve them, make nursing home visits, and that sort of thing. There's value in getting everyone involved in this project, whether they've got a direct stake in what's happening or not. And the other thing that stands out in chapter 3 is how often you read the phrase next to him, next to them, the next section over, something like that. Meremoth repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshullam made repairs. Next to him, Zadok also made repairs, and so on. The building of the wall was accomplished because so many people were mobilized together. It wasn't one work crew making their way around the perimeter of Jerusalem doing all of the work. Everyone came and did their part. It would have been easy for some of these folks to look at the little section of wall that they'd been assigned to and think, well, I don't really see what the point is. I got this 15 by 15 section of wall that I'm supposed to repair, and you know, what difference is that going to make? But then if they would look next to them, look to their right, and they would see their neighbor. Look to their left, and they'd see their neighbor on the other side. And all the way around the wall, everybody's doing their part to repair this section, to repair this greater project of this wall. And the same thing goes for us. It's tempting to think, well, you know, my vision for Christ just isn't that big. Maybe as I'm talking about this these last few weeks, you're thinking, well, for me it has something to do with my marriage. Or it has something to do with my family or my place of work. That's my vision, is just to make my place of work a better place. And how big a difference can that make in the grand scope of things? You know, what difference does my marriage make in the bigger picture? What difference is my place of work going to make in the bigger picture? It's tempting to think, well, my vision is just so small. But look to your left. Look to your right. If you're doing your part to live out your God-given vision, and the person sitting next to you is doing his or her part, and the family sitting behind you is doing their part, and the family sitting in front of you is doing their part, and if everybody in our church is doing our part to live out God's vision for us, and every other Christian in Spencer was doing their part, and every Christian throughout America was doing their part, and every Christian throughout the world, think of the impact that would start to have. We mustn't get tunnel vision to see only our part. We need to remember that we're in this together. Always remember that you're part of something so much bigger. This is the power of vision. Vision has the power to move us and sustain us in the work and help us to accomplish way more than we ever thought possible by ourselves. It had the power to rally the dispirited people of Jerusalem to build a wall in 52 days. It has the power to, you know, keep me going in ministry for the last 20 years. It can motivate and sustain you as well. So inspect, take an honest assessment of where things stand. Inspire, paint a compelling picture of the future. How are things going to be different? And then mobilize, take your place in the larger work of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we walk down this journey of discovering and clarifying your call on our lives, giving name to it and description to it, just as Nehemiah did in envisioning the changes that could be made in Jerusalem. We pray, Lord, that you would be speaking to us. Help us to see the areas where things need to change. Help us to paint a clear picture of how things can be different. Help us to see how our part of living out your calling on us contributes to making this world a different place. In your name we pray. Amen. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion.